In this video, we're going to take a look at WebRTC. In the WebSocket video, we saw that both a client and a server could exchange data in real time through WebSocket. Therefore, WebSocket is very useful in services such as chat. Here we have two users chatting with each other through a chat app. When one sends a message, it appears in real time in the other's app. These two users are not actually directly connected. Rather, they are having a conversation through the server. When one client sends a message, the server relays it. The server then transmits it to another client. As one may easily guess, this method can put a heavy burden on the server as the number of clients increases. Especially if the size of the data exchanged between clients becomes larger, it will become even more burdensome for the server. For example, in cases where audio or video needs to be exchanged in real time, if the traffic increases to the point that the server can handle it, not only will the cost of using the server increase, but the service will also slow down. Then, what if the clients could communicate directly with each other without the mediation of the server? The server wouldn't need to deal with the data being exchanged between clients, and the clients would be able to communicate more pleasantly and quickly without going through a third party. The thing that makes this possible is WebRTC. In WebRTC, client programs like browsers, mobile apps, desktop applications connect directly with each other and exchange data. Therefore, many services that provide voice calls or video chat functions are implemented using this WebRTC. Let's find out how WebRTC works. Two users want to make a video call through a video chat service. These two are not directly connected to each other yet. For them to communicate peer-to-peer, they must go through a process called signaling. Signaling is the process where the two clients agree on what to communicate and how to communicate. This signaling takes place through a server, and how to implement this is not specified by WebRTC. Developers can choose and implement an appropriate protocol from options like WebSocket, HTTP, etc. Signaling employs a protocol called SDP. In simple terms, SDP is a form that writes what to communicate with and how to communicate. The structure of the SDP looks like this. It determines how session information, network-related information, media types, and stream properties are written. And on the right is an example of SDP, written according to that structure.
Do I have to learn this and write it myself?
Of course, it's not something developers write or read directly, but a format handled by the library. Among the many pieces of information in the SDP, there is, what will we communicate with? This includes information such as the types of media like video or audio, their formats, codecs, resolution, etc. There's nothing overly complicated here. The tricky part is how to communicate. The clients send information about the network paths that each can use for communication. We call this an ICE candidate. It's like saying, I can use one of these and showing options, candidates, to the other party. There are three types of candidates. The host candidate is the simplest case. It's when two users are in the same local network, like in a house or an office. Here, we exchange the private IP addresses and port numbers for the internal use of each device. Just as in a building, if you know each other's room numbers, you can meet. But this is not the general case. Video calls are usually made between people who are far apart, at least on networks that use different public IP addresses. In these cases, server reflexive candidate is often used. Usually, the client devices of general users are connected to the network via NAT. I'll make a separate video later, but to explain NAT simply, it's where multiple devices access the internet through a single public IP address. To communicate with a specific device, you need to know the public IP address of the router the device is connected to and the port number allocated to that device. With these two combined as each individual's address, direct communication between clients occurs. The problem is, the client doesn't know these two, because they usually don't need to know. Moreover, these things can usually change from time to time, so it's necessary to find out the current public IP and the address and port. What is used to obtain this information is STUN. Services implemented with WebRTC have a specific STUN server designated. The client sends requests to this STUN server. In response, the STUN server tells the client's public IP address and port number. So, you use the STUN service to find out my address to inform the other party. Since STUN is provided for free or at a low cost by many service companies like Google, Twilio, Sirsis, AWS, Koton, and more, there's no need for a developer to implement it on their own. The path information obtained through the stun service is registered as the second candidate for ICE. However, depending on the network environment and settings, this method can also be difficult. This could be the case if the network environment is complex, or if P2P communication is restricted by firewalls and the like. In that case, the last resort would be a turn server. Clients communicate through this turn server, keeping it in between them. As you can easily guess, this involves taking additional routes, increasing latency, and incurring costs, so it's used as a last option.
So, do I have to implement this server like a signal server?
Just like stun servers, turn servers can use external services or can be implemented and developed directly to save costs and improve performance. Thus, each client includes their available ICE candidate information in their SDP and sends it to the other party. Through this, they verify what and how they can communicate with each other, and then they choose the best method, set up the connection, and start serious P2P communication. In this process, data transmission mainly uses protocols like SRTP and SCTP, which are suitable for the characteristics and purposes of communication. In WebRTC, communication usually takes place through things like video chats or voice calls, so these protocols are based on UDP, which is suitable for fast, high-capacity transmission, rather than TCP, which guarantees the reliability of information. For those who don't know what TCP and UDP are, let me explain briefly. TCP is used in situations where all data needs to be sent without any omissions, even if it slows down a little. UDP is used in cases like video streaming, where fast transmission is important and it's okay if some content is lost in the middle. In WebRTC, SRTP, which is suitable for real-time transmission of video or audio, is most commonly used. But when it comes to file transfers, even a slight bit of missing content can ruin the file, making UDP a difficult option. For SCTP, even though it's based on UDP, it is designed to ensure reliability like TCP, so it's used for file transfers. Like the SSE from the previous video, WebRTC is also provided as an API by modern browsers, so you can implement the client in JavaScript without installing any other libraries. If you visit the WebRTC API page on MDN, you can explore how to use it in detail. In other environments, such as mobile apps or desktop programs, you can use the library to implement WebRTC. Thus, due to the direct connection between clients, standardized implementation, high compatibility, and inherently encrypted communication method, WebRTC is widely used in real-time video chats, meetings, and remote collaboration tasks. However, depending on the network environment, there may be constraints such as the need to use a turn server. In fact, performance may decrease in cases where many users participate in many-to-many communication. For many-to-many communications, additional technologies such as SFU or MCU should be applied. We'll look into these if we cover related topics in the future. In this video, we've looked at WebRTC in this way. In the next video, we'll explore another way to exchange messages, which is Message Broker. See you in the next video.